Hello, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick, one half of the award-winning World Footprints podcast team. The other half, my husband, Ian, is on a business call, and we're practicing a little bit of social distancing right now. So it's just me. You know, the thing about this coronavirus is that it may keep us physically disconnected, but it doesn't prevent us from connecting in other means that adhere to the guidelines imposed for our health and safety. And so today we're actually traveling to Japan and connecting with Chuck Johnson. Chuck is an actor, a model, a small business owner. I know I'm missing a lot of things on his very lengthy resume, but most importantly, he's my brother. So Chuck, thank you so much for joining us today from Tokyo.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure. It's good to see you and good to see that you're still healthy.
Yeah, ditto, ditto. So tell me, first of all, how are you? How's the family? How's Ty and Mari?
Oh, everybody's fine. Everybody's fine. So, you know, I mean, as with people everywhere, you know, everybody's a little bit freaked out. Everybody's a little bit scared and stressed out. But, you know, that's given the circumstances, I think that's to be expected. So, you know, that fact aside, everybody's doing well.
Good, good. Now, how, you know, Japan has been in the news a lot here. What is the status today?
Japan's in a really interesting place with this because basically, I think much really, really early on, you know, Prime Minister Abe, you know, he closed the schools. And then as a function of the schools closing, basically without any necessary prompting, businesses all started shutting down, just as a function of the fact that the schools were shutting down. So then basically people kind of put themselves into lockdown just as a precaution as to what they were seeing. And that was happening for about a month or so. And then because of that, and because of a range of other factors, and you know, people are saying that there's a degree of underreporting as well, basically the numbers stayed really low here while they were just starting to skyrocket everywhere else. So now the position that we're in is that people are already getting tired of having been cooped up for like a month, and people are starting to venture out again. But we just went into our first official lockdown as of tomorrow. So everything is already kind of shut down today. So, but even then, what the government policy right now is, because the numbers are still low, it's only going to be a weekend lockdown. So they're trying to stop people from physically gathering, because most Japanese people work until really late anyway. So they're still allowing people to go to work during the week, and then they're just locking down on the weekends for the next 3 weeks.
But are are they imposing social distancing guidelines? So are they mandating that people stay 6 feet apart?
Yeah. I mean, there's social distancing guidelines. And, you know, you're basically seeing all the same advice on how to kind of stop the spread that you see everywhere else. Of course, wash your hands for a minimum of 20 seconds, you know, use hand sanitizers, keep distances and all that. But I think one of the other reasons that Japan has been really fortunate is, as a generally, Japanese people have been living in extremely tight places for a very long time. So as a function of that, this is already an extremely sterile place. That and the fact that they eat raw food all the time. So they're really, really intense about cleanliness, you know. So this, and again, because they live in such tight places and everyone rides extremely crowded trains all the time, people have already been wearing masks. People always wear masks here. So, and even if the masks don't necessarily do any good for protecting you, they do catch whatever comes out of your mouth. So they kind of protect everyone else from you, which means if everybody does it, it does actually have a positive effect. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, you know, again, just kind of as a function of the fact that they've been living in this kind of really tight space for so long, the culture is already one of social distance. Basically, there's very, very, very little physical affection here in general. People almost never touch each other at all. Even within families, you know, people, adult children, they never even hug, basically. Mm. And, there's very, very little touching to begin with here. And in general, Japanese people, they kind of keep distance from everybody anyway. So in one respect, this is a culture that's kind of very well suited for dealing with this from the onset. It's much less hard for them to adapt to this than it is for everybody else.
Mm-hmm. It must be hard, the no hugging, because we grew up in a family that hugs. So
yeah, it's really you know, then like you touch people and they're like, whoa, right? Like, because it's weird for them because they just don't touch. So that's right. You know, I mean, I've been here for 18 years, so I'm used to it, you know. But that is as a very, very huggable American, you know, that's trying to get used to it, you know.
I get it. So I know I mentioned Ty earlier, your son, my nephew, who is 7, I believe.
He's four, he's turning five.
Oh my gosh. Okay. All right. So he's really not in sorry.
He's just really, really big for a 4-year old. He's 7 yet. He's an easy mistake. Everybody thinks he's way older. They're like, why doesn't he talk better? And I'm like, he's only 4.
Well, but it just seems so long ago since he was born to me. That's why I thought he was around that age. So he's not in school per se. Maybe was he in nursery school or?
Nursery school.
Okay, all right. And so, how have you adapted to these restrictions, the lockdowns, with a small child?
We've been lucky in that his school didn't close down. They were closing down from elementary schools on, but nursery school stayed open. So he's still been going to school. So we've been really, really lucky. This weekend will be our first time where all three of us are just going to be have to be at home in the house all day together.
Mm-hmm.
So basically in Japan, it's kind of just been, except for the fact that everyone's being extremely careful and everyone's wearing masks and people aren't going out socially as much. Other than that, it's kind of still just been business as usual. People are still going to work. Some people are still going to like drinking events and things afterwards, but generally most people look down on that. Like what are you doing, right? So.
And I mentioned, you know, you're a small business owner. Because businesses have closed for the most part, is the government offering any assistance to small business owners or even workers in the gig economy?
That's an interesting question because there's been talk of this and there's been talk of that, but nothing's been decided yet. So originally, one thing that I heard is going to happen is that the Japanese government is offering 0% loans to small business owners because even just from the schools closing down, and then as soon as the schools were shut down for a month, like I said, tons of people stopped going to like bars and restaurants and things like that. They just stopped in observance of this. And for small businesses or even medium-sized businesses that were just hanging on, all those businesses basically got wiped out during that month. Mm-hmm. So now the government's saying, okay, we're going to give 0% interest loans so that people can restart those businesses. Or for the people that have gotten into a bad place, they can kind of get back to where they're supposed to be. The smaller businesses, everybody's been hit. So, yeah.
And so is there a lot of nervousness, anxiety around what's happening? Because Japan doesn't seem to be as affected as we thought it was or it is.
No, you know what? At this point, in the beginning, everyone was super nervous. And then the numbers stayed low. And now people are starting to get confident and they're starting to go back outside, which is actually kind of a problem because it's a false sense of security because obviously this is happening everywhere else in the world and it's going to happen here too. And we're at the point that we're just now seeing our curve start to steepen in terms of the impact of this. So I think that was one of the reasons why the government, you know, strongly said, okay, well, this is it. Everybody needs to stay in this weekend. And now they're trying to reinstate to people just that we're nowhere near out of the clear yet, you know.
How do people feel about the Olympics being postponed until next year?
They're saying that the postponement of the Olympics, from what I've heard, is the estimated economic loss is $6 billion. Wow. So that's going to hit people very, very hard. And like I said, a lot of small businesses across a variety of industries have already been hit by the fact that nobody's frequenting them for entertainment purposes. Mm-hmm. And like sports gyms as well, right?
But you kind of have to balance that between human life, you know, the preservation of human life and the preservation of small businesses. I mean, that's a very, it shouldn't be a hard scale to weigh, but I understand livelihoods are tied up. Like your livelihood is tied up into your small business.
Yeah. I mean, it's especially when you look at restaurant owners, because when a restaurant goes belly up, you know, you have to gut the building, right? You know, I mean, I've read about a few accounts of a guy. There was one guy I read about, and he was making about $15,000 a month from his bar. But then by contract in Japan, when you close your business, you have to return the space to its original state. And for him to do that costed him $100,000. So he went from having $15,000 a month of income to zero, and then $100,000 of debt within like 2 weeks.
Right? Oh my goodness.
You have to think about the kind of, you know, impact that that's going to have on him for the rest of his life. You know what I mean? Like, so, and that's happening to people. So I think a lot of people are way more worried about the economic impact here than they are about the actual virus, especially because for a lot of people, you know, the symptoms they get it's more or less just a bad cold.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, it is deadly for some people, but for most people, it's kind of just like a bad cold, right?
Yeah.
Well, they're more worried about the economic impact.
So the death toll in Japan is nowhere near as high as it has been here or across Europe, which is really good to hear. But I think it sounds like it's putting, as you mentioned, people in a place of false security and complacency almost with regards to, you know, their health and well-being.
Yeah. I mean, it is an issue. But one of the interesting things about here is that in general, you know, people are, I don't quite know how to say it, but it's, you know, people do as they're told, right? So if the government says shut down, they just shut down, you know, and this shutdown, it's completely voluntary because the Japanese government or the constitution is written in such a way that the government can't really force businesses to shut down. But they just said, we want to do a shutdown and then everything shut. And then everyone that I know is staying in, right? Mm-hmm. So just because they're saying, well, that's what the government says we need to do. So that's what we need to do for, you know, the sake of preserving Japan, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, so there is a crisis on a smaller scale than we're experiencing here. And usually we see people come together when there are either natural disasters or crises like pandemics. What acts of kindness have you witnessed or experienced or even offered? Are you seeing community come together during this time?
You know, it's been interesting because, like I said, here it hasn't been that bad yet. So people are still kind of just conducting themselves as business as usual. But I know, you know, my main area of business is, you know, I run a martial arts school right in the middle of Tokyo, and this is I kind of feel like this whole thing has brought me a lot closer to the parents of the kids that I teach, right? Because we're all just updating each other and you know, I've got a group, a Facebook group of all my parents, and then anytime anyone finds an article, we share it and we discuss what's happening and you know, different strategies and things for you know, dealing with this. You know, I try to do for the parents who've had their kids in, you know, whose kids haven't been in school for the past month, especially the parents of multiple kids, you know, so they've been at home with three kids just every day, all day for a month. I try to do anything I can to just help them.
Even if it's just a phone call to say hello and help distract them from the day to day.
Yeah, or just an email to say, just to let you know, like, I really respect you, you know, just whatever I can, you know, I mean, I've only got one kid and being with him, and like, I love him to death and he's the best thing ever, but being at home all day with him is just, it's, wow, he's got a lot of energy.
Well, he has your energy. I remember you were a very hyperactive kid, if memory serves me right.
So. Yeah, that's about right. And he never, ever, ever stops asking questions.
Oh, that's a good thing.
He never stops. I love it. But I spent, while I was getting ready for bed, I think I spelled about 60 different words because he's like, Daddy, how do you spell this? Daddy, how do you spell this? How about this? How about this? We went through every single kind of car. And then every car maker, and then every household item, and he just had me spelling them one after another, for no reason that I know of.
Oh, our tie. He gives me hope for the future. I mean, for a four-year-old to be that inquisitive and want to learn how to that's a beautiful thing. So keep it up. Keep it up, bro. I'll send you some Bull Run or whatever that caffeinated drink is.
Yeah.
So after all of this is done, is there anything that you want to do or a place you want to go? I mean, it doesn't sound like you're on lockdown, you know, per se.
Yeah, we're not in a hard lockdown. It's just it's an optional lockdown over the weekends, right? Yeah.
And what are you doing to distress during these times, particularly? You know, when you have very long days as you did today and you're tired and you're run down and then your sister says, hey, can you do a video interview with me at midnight?
Honestly, I'm just trying to stay productive. You know, I'm just trying to stay productive. Like, I use the time to clean if I can. Just because generally for myself, usually I never get home before 11 o'clock at night. So, and I work almost 7 days a week. So, I don't get to see the inside of my house this much. So like, I'm kind of going through and like finding things that need to be cleaned and finding things that need to be organized as in so much as Ty is letting me anyway. And I'm turn it into just productive time, you know?
Wow.
What I really want to do as soon as I can is I want to come back to America and I want to visit everybody because I know I can't go home right now. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to come home. I really, really wanted to come home in April, to you know, see Aunt Michelle and Aunt Nora and Aunt Vern. I was planning to come back for a little while. Now I just can't, you know. So as soon as things are safe, I'd like to go home and eat, you know, Meat Lover's pizza and maybe a very large bacon cheeseburger. And kind of drive my car and hang out.
Is what yeah. I would like to do. And we wanted to travel to Japan for the Olympic Games. So our trip is going to be postponed for another year, but we still have our media credentials. So, and we're looking forward to seeing you next year, hopefully before then. And we always have this online platform to connect. I will let you go back to, I'll let you go to bed. First of all, Chuck, thank you so much for staying up late to talk to me and our audience and to share what's happening in Japan. We're all very curious and very hopeful that what you're experiencing there, just the hopefully the flattening of the curve to some extent will reach us at some point. Yeah. But stay safe, get some rest, give my love, our love to the family. And thank you so much for joining us. And I thank our audience for joining us wherever you are. Stay safe, stay healthy. And let's just keep building those connections in spite of the social distancing. Good night.
Good night.